I have actually been looking forward for a long time to this conference here in Goa for many reasons. I like the science here. I like the people here. And this time there was also an extra reason for me, because this is the first time I'm traveling with my oldest son alone to a conference. That gives a special feeling. Actually, it's not his first Hyperfine conference. It's his third Hyperfine conference, because my son was there already in the previous edition in Leuven. He joined the tour, he joined the conference banquet, which is not too difficult because Leuven is our hometown, so that was nearby. But there was also a time before. He was present in this Hyperfine conference. Do some people recognize the picture? Where was it? Foz do Iguaçu, Iguaçu Falls in Argentina, Brazil, in 2007. Which is situated almost at the opposite side of the world as where we are sitting now. This is Josse traveling to Iguaçu Falls 12 years ago. This is Josse traveling to Goa just a few days ago. So you see, time has passed meanwhile. Now, after that Hyperfine conference in Iguaçu Falls, we spent a holiday in Brazil. And one of the places we visited was Salvador da Bahia, which is a bit more up to the north. And one of the things we visited in that city was a center where they explained everything about the green sea turtle. You see here Josse with a green sea turtle, a real living animal. And what is special about this green sea turtle? They told us the story there. They live in, here you see another picture of Wikipedia, which can of course offer nicer photographs than we could do. So what is special about this green sea turtle? It lives most of the time of the year in the waters of the coasts in front of Brazil. It feeds there. But to reproduce, to deposit eggs, it swims 2,000 kilometers into the ocean to a few small islands. There are perfect beaches there to deposit eggs of green sea turtles. Why would that animal do that? Because that's an enormous distance that costs lots of energy. It's very inefficient, it's stupid to spend energy in such an activity. There are other beaches much more nearby which are reasonably acceptable as well. Biologists do not completely agree about the reason, but one interesting hypothesis is that this is a consequence of continental drift. Long ago, millions of years ago, the continents were in different positions, and that island was much, much closer to the coast of Brazil. So imagine the sea turtle knows, there is an island a few kilometers out of the coast which is perfect for my eggs. I swim there, deposit the eggs and go back. The next year, continental drift, that island is 5 millimeters further away. The turtle doesn't notice. 2 generations further, that island is 1 meter further away. The turtles do not notice. And that keeps going on until the islands are 2,000 kilometers away. The turtle still didn't notice and just adapted to becoming a good swimmer. That shows us that an activity which is very relevant at one point in time can become irrelevant and even stupid if the situation changes. And if the situation changes slowly enough, we will not notice and we will continue to do this inefficient activity. That is what I would like to relate to the story of teaching. And I will discuss more in detail what I call the automation of knowledge transfer. How teaching can evolve from something where you need a human to something that is in some sense, not completely, but in some sense automated. And what are the benefits of that. So let's jump into the history of teaching, and I will inspect one variable. I will inspect this degree of automation on the vertical axis as a function of time. You will see a curve developing, a black line that indicates the amount of automation. We start very far back in the most basic situation you can imagine. I took as an example ancient Greece, but you could probably tell the same about ancient India, about any historical culture. Let's imagine you know something that I don't know. How can I get to know what you know? Well, we sit together and you tell me. Your voice, that's the only device you have in a prehistoric culture. If there are multiple people that do not know what you know, well, let's sit together in a group. You tell us, you teach us. How many people can we gather? Well, as far as your voice goes without amplification. We noticed earlier in this conference, if the amplification is not there, this room is too big for teaching with a voice. So that defines a relatively small area, a classroom, we call it today, which is the natural unit where you teach with your voice. As soon as it becomes bigger, you will need other things. You will need more technology. So my level of automation, my dependence on the human teacher is at the very basic level. No automation at all. That's our baseline. History evolves, humans evolve, and we invent something that can help us getting rid of that limitation. People developed the act of writing. And writing initially was not something as we know it today. Writing was something very expensive. When I talk about these first books, think about books you can find only in one library in one city or in the house of a very rich person. Books were not something that common people had. There was a lot of resistance against the appearance of books. There were famous people in history, even in the history of teaching, who very much opposed this. Plato, the big Greek philosopher, told, imagine if we allow students to write down their thoughts, they will forget the capability of memorizing anything. So he was very much against books. Books were killing education. History showed that this didn't really happen. This fear was not justified. And keep that as a warning. If there are big changes in education, it's not necessarily bad. So our level of automation goes slightly up. Then happens something that is really the biggest revolution in education ever. Our curve goes very steeply up. And what is that? The invention of the printing process. These very expensive books that were only available in these few libraries can now become commodity products. That initially every teacher got a copy of the book, later on every student got a copy of the book. And as a consequence, you could even imagine to learn without a teacher present. You could just read it from the book. The teacher was still useful to ask questions to, but if you wanted, you could get rid of the classroom and study on your own. And there have been many people in the past centuries who have taken advantage of that. Books, printing, that's only written texts. There is more information you would like to use in the teaching process, like sound or moving images. And we developed some technology for that. Technology for sound. This is a device I encountered in teaching when I was a 10-year-old boy learning French. We had the dialogues of our French course book on such a vinyl disc. And the teacher, we are now going to lecture 2. So I will put the needle on the correct position for lecture 2. And you could listen to the dialogue of lecture 2. after having listened to the last sentences of the dialogue of lesson one, because that needle wasn't positioned very correctly. But we had sound, very impractical, but we had sound in our education. We even had moving images. And our National Broadcasting Corporation was broadcasting throughout the day programs, especially for schools. So you could go with your class at the right time to the only place in the school where there was a television set, and we could watch a program just for that particular course. Very impractical, but we had moving images. Because all these were impractical, they didn't get used very much. So it was waiting for the second biggest revolution in education before sound and moving images became really practical. And you see the curve going up really steeply now. That was the appearance of the internet. Thanks to the internet, not only text, but also sound and images, moving images can float freely around the world and reach virtually everybody, without the need of the human teacher being present with that material. So now your independence of the human teacher is maximal. So a short tour through the history of education from the point of view of automation. However, if we look at the daily practice, and if we look at a medieval class, we see a teacher broadcasting information to the students in that classroom. And if we then inspect a typical class today, we see a teacher broadcasting information to the students in the classroom. Here we have the turtle. The circumstances have changed completely. We have internet with everything I just mentioned. In the Middle Ages, they didn't have that at all. And still, we are doing the same things. We are used to our classroom setup, and we keep doing that in spite of the changing world around us. Let's do then a thought experiment. Let's imagine that we can now just erase the education system that we have. We start from a clean table again. How can we reinvent education, making use of the technologies that there are today? And as an example, as a case study if you want, I will use this online course on hyperfine interactions, which you find at that website. I will not particularly emphasize two things for the rest of this talk, but I will mention them once now. This course is devised as a low-budget effort, so it's something you can do with a couple of hundreds of euros of dollars, no astronomical budgets, and it's something that is manageable in terms of workload. It's basically a one-person project. People can make online courses for 100,000 euros. There are companies that do that for you, but this is the low-budget, low-person version. The classroom. If we would teach hyperfine interactions before technology, we would do it this way. And what are we actually doing in that classroom? Two important things. One is what you would naturally think about, sending content. The teacher sends content, information to the student. However, from the point of view of the student, this process isn't always very efficient. Let's look into the heads of the students in that audience. What are they thinking? This student thinks, this might be interesting, but that was now too fast. I cannot follow. Where is the pause button? Sorry, the teacher has no pause button. Another student, I know this stuff, I've seen this last year and the year before. Can I speed this up a little, please? Teacher has no speed up button. There might be another student who would find that class, that lecture very interesting, but there are overlapping schedules. He had to be in another class at the same time. So he couldn't be there, lecture lost. So to avoid these disadvantages in our approach, we do not offer content in the classroom. The classroom is not the place where you offer content. Content is offered outside of the classroom, either via printed text or via video. And this is a screenshot from one of the pages of the website of this course on hyperfine interactions. I take out of the chapter NMR and NQR the topic orientation of a nuclear ensemble. So you see there a 7-minute simple video that explains the concept of orientation of a nuclear ensemble. That's where the students get their content. In most of the cases, these are videos I made myself after my laptop, behind my laptop, but I can also take resources from other places. Like the previous Hyperfine conference has been fully recorded as well. And if there is an interesting topic there that fits into the course, I happily borrow from this source of information. Similarly, this week, if you tell something that would be interesting for that audience, I will happily borrow this and insert in the course. And many more people than there are available in this room will be able to learn from this material. So content out of the class, video or text. What else are students thinking inside such a lecture? Well, one of the good features of a lecture setting is that you can ask questions. That's what people often take as the big advantage of a classroom. But many, many students, especially if the classroom becomes large, hesitate to ask questions. They are too shy. And I don't blame them for them. That's a normal human reaction. But the result is, the question is never asked. On the other hand, imagine that you are the very best possible teacher who has this magical gift to get questions out of your students. With you as a teacher, they feel very comfortable to ask a question. Raise my hand, I have a question. But if you are really that good teacher, and if one person does it, other people will do it as well. And after a while, your lecturing time, or what was meant as your lecturing time, is totally cluttered by answering questions. You do not get to the point anymore of offering content. And that was what you wanted to do in your lecture. So what we do is, as we have removed the content delivery outside the lecture room, we can use the lecture room to answer questions. How do these questions get to us? Well, two ways. The first one is, I got lost in my thought. So two ways of this for the students to ask questions. Either they can use a form inside the course. Every page of the course has a link to a form, a Google form, where they can insert their question and we get a nice list of all the questions of that week. Or implicitly via tasks. All of these videos come with a specific task. Students have to submit reports on these tasks every week. And from reading the reports, we see where people struggle, so what items need to be addressed in the next classroom session. So I said there are two important items in a classroom setting. Content delivery, very important, but that we moved outside the classroom. The second aspect is feedback. And that's often forgotten in the traditional approach. A very important aspect in the learning process is telling students where they are in their learning process. If they make a mistake, that's not a problem, but they should get the reaction from you that is a mistake for this and this and this reason. That is a very powerful learning mechanism. But in our lecture setting, in our classroom setting, there is not really a place for that. You might think about office hours where a few students can go, or exercise sessions where maybe the students that are not shy can can ask some questions and get some feedback, but most of the students do not get feedback in a structured, regular way. How do we address the feedback topic? Well, that is where we use that weekly classroom setting for. Part of the tasks are semi-automated. So when students submit a task related to a video, in some cases, after submitting, they get a standard answer and they can evaluate whether what they just submitted was correct or not. That's immediate feedback, automated. Or they have to submit their answer on some kind of discussion environment. And by the reactions or answers from other students, they see whether they got it right or not, and they can help each other out. For those tasks where that is not foreseen, they submit it to the teacher. And so we look through that list, to that set of tasks, and in the weekly feedback session, we then report what were the most common mistakes we detected, and we explain what went wrong. Also, these question forms, they are dealt with in that sessions. So this is how it would look like on the website. This is a video here, 1 hour, 15 minutes of this one weekly classroom session. In this, that was the topic of last year about NMR and NQR. What is happening there is just giving feedback. Students can come to that session personally if they want to. That session is also live streamed, so if they want to watch from their home, they can do. And if they have overlapping lectures, well, it's also recorded, so they can watch the other day. Multiple ways to get that feedback. Here is the example of how such a question form looks like. And this is an example of a task. Here in this specific task, report the Landé G factor for the ground state of the lanthanum atom when it is inside lanthanum metal. There is a short reasoning they have to follow, and they can do that if they understood the video that came before. And in this particular case, one student typed in the forum, "I don't know how the G factor can be calculated in that case." Well, I display this answer in the feedback webinar to show, some people struggle with this. So if you struggle with that, don't be ashamed. There are others who have the same problem. And I also show there were students who made an attempt to answer that question. So they seem to know some things that you didn't realize. So it's not impossible that you learn to know this. Others did it. Others with the same background as you could do it. So maybe you can even help each other out. So establish connections. These are the activities that happen in the feedback webinar. That was about the organization of that course. What is the content? There are two main sections. One of them is about the physics of hyperfine interactions. And what you see there are the typical things you have in a course on hyperfine interactions: the electric monopole shift, the magnetic hyperfine interaction, the electric quadrupole interaction. The second part is about experimental methods that make use of hyperfine interactions. And the list of methods that is currently dealt with is the one you see there. So many of the topics we have met in the past few days: laser spectroscopy, NMR, synchrotron radiation methods, PAC, are covered in this method section. So that was how it was organized until a few years ago. And the reason why it was organized that way is that this course evolved from a traditional classroom course. This is the typical content you would offer in a classroom course. However, the learners on the internet, the online learners, they are a different kind of student. They often don't want to learn one entire course. They have a particular need. Now I'm searching for the answer to this particular gap in my knowledge. I want to learn this very specific thing. And also, I want to learn it now. I don't want to wait 5 months until I can attend a course on that subject. So in order to serve that audience in a better way, the course got structured differently over time, and there are still plans for further modifications. The first modification that was done, and which is the actual version, that was cutting this course in 2 independent courses. The A part on the hyperfine physics, you can do as a standalone course. And it can end in, I call it a certificate, but it's not something with any legal value. It's just a document that at the moment I still have to type manually, but later on that can be automated, that testifies that according to the logs of the website, you have gone through all the items and you have submitted all the required tasks. So just for the hyperfine physics. If you know already hyperfine physics and you are just interested in experimental methods, then you can directly go to the B part of the course. That starts with a short summary of hyperfine physics, with a general discussion of the framework of hyperfine methods, and then follows the list of different methods that you just saw, and that too ends in an unofficial certificate. How can you interact with that material? Well, you can do the full course. You can just go through everything as the students in my class would do. That is the complete trajectory. You could also, if you know already hyperfine physics, go through the methods part independently. So that's already possible in the current version. What I would like to move to is a situation that is much more flexible, where at the beginning you go through a kind of intake module that asks you what exactly do you want to learn, and then the course software will guide you a path throughout the material that is the shortest trajectory to answer your current learning needs. For instance, I want to learn experimental method B, I want to learn about Mössbauer spectroscopy. Well, it takes you through the short hyperfine physics, the general framework, the Mössbauer spectroscopy topic, and you get your certificate for Mössbauer spectroscopy. For many people, it will stop there. They have learned what they need. But if you got interested in, I want to learn more about this, well, maybe I can add another method, and your certificate gets a bit larger. Or you can add a third method and your certificate gets larger. And so you accumulate the kind of knowledge you are interested in, the kind of knowledge you need at that moment. So it's not yet automated to that level, but that is where we want to evolve in the coming 2 years. When and how is that online course offered? There are 2 different ways to deal with it. There is the supervised version, which this year starts on February 13, tomorrow, until May 15. These are 12 lecture weeks interrupted by the Easter break in Flemish universities. So 12 series of classes and 2 weeks halfway as a break. A student that enters the supervised edition, they commit themselves to submit the weekly reports. They watch weekly the set of videos for that week. They submit the reports on these videos. And they can listen to this weekly feedback webinar where the questions they might have asked during that week will be answered. That's the supervised version. The self-paced version, that can start at any time of the year. When you feel the need to learn this, you can start the course. That is the aspect of I want to learn it now. If in June you meet a hyperfine problem, you will not want to wait until the next February to start taking this course. You take it at any moment of the year. Of course, you can then not ask questions because there is nobody at the other side actively watching to answer your questions. But okay, at least you can do the regular study. Have people done this already? Well, yes. I show here a map of the world where you see not the people who have completed the entire course. That there are not many people who have really completed everything, because, as I said, the internet learner usually studies a particular topic. But these are the list of people who have done a minimal amount of activity in the course, mainly centered in Europe, but with a few outliers in different parts of the world. Because that's the advantage of the internet, it reaches everywhere. You don't have to live in Ghent to go to Ghent University to take that course. You can take it from wherever in the world. Can your students use that course? Yes. If they want to join the supervised version, there is no problem. They can freely register to that website and they can take part in all the activities just as the students in Ghent University would do. If you know students who are interested in doing that, let them know, because tomorrow is the start of the course. So this is exactly the right moment to get started. What we do not do is offering a formal certificate, so we will not organize a legally binding exam. If your students want to take that course, they can do it as far as content is concerned, but an exam, if you want them to do an exam, they have to do that with you in according to the rules of your institution. The same holds true for the self-paced version. If you have, for instance, a PhD student starting in September who needs to have a basic education on hyperfine interactions, well, you can ask your PhD student to take that course, and then it's up to you whether you organize a formal exam for this or not, depending on your local rules and your tastes. By coincidence, just yesterday I got an email from one of the students that was taking the self-paced version, and he said, I know that the certificate for this course is symbolic, but my supervisor agreed to increase my rating if I can show them the certificate of this course, which demonstrates that there are creative ways in which this material can be used. For future developments, where are we heading with this? So far, all the video material is mainly screencast video that I made 3 years ago. I think by now I can do this much better, both on the technical level and on the ways of how the content should be scripted. That takes time, but it's definitely on the wish list to improve the video material gradually over the coming years. Implementing that concept of a menu, where the course guides you through the shortest route to the knowledge you want to have, that is definitely on the to-do list for the coming years. And something that I will not do, but that you could do, is maybe expanding some of the topics. The course has the approach of being a very general course. For somebody who knows just bachelor grade physics without something specific about hyperfine interactions, so via this course they get the broad overview. But maybe after that they would like to deepen their knowledge on one specific method. Now, if you feel like providing material, say for Mössbauer spectroscopy or for NMR, we might imagine that you could attach this material to this course as a second layer, as an expanded version of the NMR topic. So, and if many people would do that, after a while we have really a broad course for our field at the entry level and at the more specialized level. To some extent, I'm already integrating some of the talks of the Hyperfine conferences for that purpose. But there is much open space to play with really didactical content at the more advanced level. So I'm inviting you to think about that and to see whether you can contribute to this. In that way, this would not only become a Hyperfine course for the entire planet, but also a Hyperfine course where the entire planet, all the people from the Hyperfine community, can contribute to. That is the ultimate goal. I promised you food for thought for the conference dinner. So I will finish with a few provocative statements that are maybe a bit exaggerated at some point. So I will not defend every word of these statements, but that are meant as a trigger to feed the discussions of this evening. So just absorb these statements and hopefully you get upset, and then you can discuss for the rest of the day whether this is true or not. Statement number one: if it is worth to be said, it's worth to be recorded. If you offer a class or a conference lecture or whatever for an audience, then it means you are convinced that what you tell is worthwhile for that audience. So there should not be any objection to record that and offer it to the rest of the world. That should be standard practice. A stronger version of that same statement: if it is worth to be said, it must be recorded. If somebody tells me, I don't want that what I say is recorded, my reaction is now, that must be worthless content, if you even don't want it to show to everybody. Or an even stronger version: if you risk to have to tell something twice, record it the first time. It will save you a lot of time in your life. Another statement: meeting in a classroom makes sense only for those activities that you cannot possibly capture in an online format. It makes no sense to ask people to go on their bike, to go on the bus, to go in a traffic jam to a place, a geographical place, to listen to content if they can listen to the same content online. A classroom serves the purpose of doing things that you cannot do online. Education has evolved more in the past 30 years than in the 300 years before. That's this steep increase in the last part of my automation curve. Education will be online or it will not be. You would be the turtle. The current education system tends to lock up its best teachers in the black hole called the classroom. You should break the walls of the classroom and show to the world what is happening inside these classrooms. Much more efficient for much more people. For those of you who are involved in strategy at an university level, this statement is important. In the next generations, the best students, they will shop their education online. They will go to these universities that are offering the best online courses, and they will make their own program. And if your university does not offer such online courses, they will just skip you. So if you defend for too long that we are the university that is not interested in that online business and that just teaches in the good old traditional way in the classroom, you will end up with the students who do not really care about their education. The best ones will escape to better places. So my conclusion will be short. Don't be the turtle. Dare to evolve. Consider online teaching. Thank you.